Dear classmates, welcome back to Beast Part 2. In this video, we are going to continue our discussion about Output Response Analyzer. We will introduce LFSR-based Output Response Analyzer. LFSR-based Output Response Analyzer can be used in serial way, which compress one bit at a time. It can also be used in parallel way, so that we can compress multiple bits at a time. In this video, we will first focus on the serial compressor. We will introduce CRC theorem, and we will also analyze the PAL of the LFSR-based ORA, and we will tell you how to design the LFSR as an output response analyzer. This slide reviewed the structure of LFSR. In the test pattern generation lecture, we already show you that LFSR can be used as test pattern generation, which provide random pattern to a CUT. Now, in this video, we will show you LFSR can also be used as an output response analyzer with an additional input from the CUT. We take the inclusive OR of the CUT output and the feedback of the LFSR so that this LFSR can be used as an output response analyzer. This is an example. Suppose the square on the left represent a CUT which generate 9 bits of input to the LFSR, 110 110 110. Totally, there are 9 bits of output, and the right bit comes into the LFSR first. Suppose that initially all the 4 flip-flops are 0. After 4 cycles of right shift, the 4 bits of LFSR input will be shifted into the LFSR. Starting from the 4th cycle, if we clock one more cycle, a new value of Q3 will be an inclusive OR of Q2 and the Q3. So the new value of Q3 is the inclusive OR of 1 and 1, which is 0. On the left hand side, the new value of Q0 is equal to the value of input and the feedback. So we take the inclusive OR of this 1 and Q3. 1 inclusive OR 1. So we get a 0 here. So the other bits are just shifted to the right. And the rightmost bit is shifted out as LFSR output. In the 6th cycle, we can repeat the same procedure. So the new value of Q3 is 0, and the new value of Q0 is 0 inclusive or 0, which is also 0. The other bits are shifted to the right. If we continue to do this at the end of 9th cycle, we will get 1101 in the LFSR. This is what we call the signature of the LFSR. The signature is of the same size as the number of flip-flops in the LFSR. During these 9 cycles, we have Alpha's output stream, which is 10011. These 5 bits are typically discarded. They are not used in the BIST mode. Now, it's time for a quiz. Suppose that we have the same LFSR and the CUT output is 6 bits, 100100. The right bit is shifted into the LFSR first. Please fill in this table after 6 cycles. Now please pause your video and do the exercise. Okay, now back to the video. After 4 cycles, these 4 bits are shifted into our LFSR. So we have 1001. And after 1 more cycle, this bit would be 1 and this bit would be 1. LFSR output is 1. After the 6th cycle, this 1111 is our signature. And the LFSR outputs are 11. Have you got it correctly? So the signature is 1111. However, this method is really too slow. If we have 1000 bits of LFSR input stream, how can we handle this problem? Is there any better solution? Before we look into the detail, we need to introduce the cyclic redundancy code, CRC theory. In CRC theory, we can represent a stream of bits by a polynomial m of x is equal to summation I bi times x to the power of I, where x is actually a dummy variable. So this is actually not a traditionally polynomial function. In this polynomial, the exponents just represent delay, and the bit stream are represented by coefficients. For example, the LFSR input bit stream that we show in our previous example, 110110110, can be represented by x to the 8th plus x to the 7th, and the coefficient of x to the 6th is 0, so this term is not there. And eventually, we have the last bit 0 times x to the power of 0, which is 0. Please note that in this CRC notation, the rightmost bit represents the most significant bit, and the left bit represents the least significant bit. If you want to know more details, please see our reference book by Bardell or any textbook in finite field. This slide introduces the modular 2 arithmetic. In modular 2 arithmetic, addition, which is actually equal to subtraction, is an exclusive OR operation. For example, 0 plus 1 is 0, 0 plus 1 is 1, 1 plus 1 is 0. So there is no carry out, no carry in. In modular 2 arithmetic, multiplication is actually an AND operation. 0 multiplied by 0 is 0. 0 multiplied by 1 is 0. 1 multiplied by 1 is 1. The modular 2 arithmetic is also known as Galois field 2 or GF2 arithmetic. On our left-hand side, we showed a GF2 multiplication of two polynomials. When we multiply two polynomials, we can do it in a similar way as traditional algebra. However, when we add x and x, we would get 0. When we add x squared and x squared and x squared, we get only 1 x squared. This is GF2 multiplication of two polynomials. On our right hand side, we show GF2 division of two polynomials. This is the dividend polynomial and this is the divisor polynomial. We can do it in a similar way to traditional long division of polynomials. However, in GF2 division, when we subtract x to the fourth from 0, we will get x to the fourth because there is no negative coefficient in GF2 arithmetic. Suppose that n of x divided by f of x is equal to the quotient q of x with remainder r of x. If m1 of x and m2 of x have the same remainders when divided by f of x, we say that m1 of x and m2 of x are congruent. We use this notation of three horizontal lines to represent that m1 of x is congruent to m2 of x, modulo f of x. In addition, if m of x is congruent to 0, modulo f of x, we say that n of x is divisible by f of x. For example, on our right hand side, this polynomial is divisible by this polynomial because the remainder is 0. This slide shows that LFSR is actually a very simple implementation of GF2 divider. Given this input sequence 1 1 0 1 1 0 and etc, this sequence can be represented by n of x, and the characteristic polynomial of this LFSR is x to the fourth plus x cubed plus 1. Using the CRC theorem, the input m of x can be regarded as the dividend polynomial n of x, and the LFSR characteristic polynomial can be regarded as a divisor polynomial f of x. The output bitstream can be the quotient q of x, and the signature which remains in the LFSR can be regarded as the remainder r of x. So we can say that n of x is congruent to r of x modulo f of x. It's very surprising that GF2 divider can be simply implemented using an LFSR. This slide shows the details of this Galois field division. Given this input bitstream where the MSB is represented by x to the eighth, the characteristic polynomial is x to the fourth plus x cubed plus 1. Suppose that the initial contents in the LFSR are all zeros. After 9 cycles, we will get the remainder, which is the signature, equal to x cubed plus x squared plus 1. This is the R of x. And the output of the LFSR is equal to x to the 4th plus x plus 1. So we can write down this GF2 division in this way. M of x divided by f of x is equal to q of x with remainder r of x. Now it's time for you to do the exercise. Given a 6-bit input bit sequence 100100, where the write bit enters the LFSR first, please use GF2 division to find the quotient and the remainder. Now please pause the video and work on this problem. Are you ready for the answer? Now let's have a try. We can represent the input dividend bit stream by the polynomial x to the 5th plus 0. There is no x to the 4th in this input bit stream, and no x cubed plus x squared plus 0 plus 0. This is the input m of x, and the divisor is x to the 4th plus x cubed plus 1. Now we can work on this problem because the MSB is x to the 5th, so the quotient is x. So we have x 5th plus x to the 4th plus x. So now we have x to the 4th plus 0 plus x squared plus x. And we can have one more bit in the quotient, which is 1. So we have x 4 plus x cubed plus 1. So in the remainder, we have x cubed, x squared plus x plus 1. So the signature is 1111. And the quotient is 1, 1. Now we have verified our answer is correct. This slide explains why LFSR is a divider. For modular form LFSR or type 2 LFSR, actually it performs a shift and add operation. This is exactly the same as shift and subtract operation, which is actually a mod f of x divider. Given this input polynomial n of x, and given this characteristic polynomial f of x, suppose that initially the LFSR contents are all zero. After 4 cycles, we shift in the first 4 bits into the LFSR. So the first bit would correspond to x to the 8th, and x to the 7th, and x to the 6th, and x to the 5th. and etc. Since the most significant bit of the input bit stream is 1, so the quotient will be 1. So the output of this LFSR is the quotient. And the feedback of this LFSR actually performs a subtraction operation. Because this bit is 1, this bit is 1. So after the exclusive OR operation, the result will be 0. So the number here corresponds to this term in this long division. Also, we have another feedback here, which corresponds to the subtraction of x to the fourth here. So after the shift and the subtract operation, we are left with x to the fifth, and there's no x to the fourth, and there's no x to the third. We have x squared plus x. This corresponds to the polynomial here. So this modular form LFSR actually performs the same operation as Galois field 2 division. This is why we call this a modular form LFSR. So how about type 1 standard form LFSR? If you remember, for type 1 LFSR, the exclusive OR is actually outside of the shift register. So the structure is not the same as the modular form LFSR. Given the same LFSR input bit stream, suppose the initial contents in the LFSR are all zero. After 9 cycles, the signature in the type 1 LFSR will be 1001, which represented by x cubed plus 1. This is actually not the remainder. So we know that standard form LFSR is actually not a GF2 divider. With the CRC theorem in mind, now we can analyze the aliasing probability of LFSR. This slide shows the linearity of signature. Suppose that M1 of X and M2 of X are different input bit stream to the LFSR. We know that M1 of X plus M2 of X parenthesis modular F of X is congruent to parenthesis M1 of X modular F of X parenthesis plus parenthesis M2 of X modular F of X and then modular F of X. For example, suppose that a polynomial N3 is equal to M1 of X plus M2 of X. Let's say that this polynomial can be divided into N1 of X and M2 of X. Then we know that for M1 of X, the signature is 1 plus x2 plus x3. For M2 of X, The signature is x cubed plus x squared plus x plus 1. So the summation of this two input bit stream would result in a signature x, which is the summation of two signatures. So we can conclude that signature of summation of input is congruent to summation of signatures of inputs. So what is aliasing? Suppose that n good of x represent a CUT good output. So R good of x is the golden signature. N faulty of x is the output of a faulty CUT. So R faulty of x is a faulty signature. Aliasing occurs when the good signature is the same as the faulty signature. For example, suppose the good CUT output is this bit stream, and the remainder x cubed plus x squared plus 1 is the gold signature. Suppose a faulty circuit produce this bit stream. Because the remainder x is not the same as the gold signature, so the fault is detected, there's no aliasing. However, for a second faulty CUT where the output bit stream is this, and the remainder is the same as the gold signature, x cubed plus x squared plus 1. In this case, we cannot distinguish the good and the bad CUT, so we have aliasing. In summary, aliasing occurs when the good remainder polynomial is the same as the faulty remainder polynomial. So when does this aliasing condition occur? Suppose that m good of x is the good CUT output, m faulty of x is the faulty CUT output, m error of x is equal to the difference between m faulty and m good. So we can write down this equation. M faulty of x is equal to m good of x plus m error of x. Aliasing occurs when the faulty signature is equal to the good signature. That means faulty m of x is congruent to m good of x modulo f of x. That means m good of x plus m error of x is congruent to m good of x. That means m good of x is congruent to 0. So we can say that the aliasing occurs when m error of x is divisible by f of x. Now, let's have a quiz. Suppose that m good of x is this polynomial, and the gold signature is x cubed plus x squared plus 1. Suppose we have a faulty CUT output, which is this polynomial. We have aliasing. Question number 1. Please show us what's the m error of x. Question number 2. Use Galois field long division to verify that m error of x is congruent to 0 modulo f of x. Now please pause the video and work on this problem. Okay, are you done yet? M, error of x is the difference between the good and the faulty input. So we can compare these two input sequence and we can easily get that error is equal to x to the fifth plus x to the fourth plus x. This is the m error of x. Now we can use long division . This is m error of x, this is f of x. When we divide these two polynomials, we will get simply x and the remainder is 0. So we show that m error of x is congruent to 0 modulo f of x. This is why we have aliasing. Now we would like to estimate the aliasing probability of FSR. Assume that input bit stream is m of x. The length of input is m bits. We define that m faulty of x is equal to m good of x plus m error of x, like we show here in this equation. This is our m good of x, and this is our m error of x. Suppose one bit is changed by the faulty circuit. So the m faulty of x is like this. In this example, the length of the output bit is 5. If we assume that the divisor is f of x, the degree is capital N. In this model, every bit has equal probability of being flipped. That means every bit in m error of x can be 1 with equal probability. Now we can know that the total number of errors that can occur in this m bit stream is actually equal to the total number of non-zero m of x polynomials. Since we have m bits in the m of x, so there will be 2 to the m minus 1 combination. This is in the denominator of our aliasing probability. In the numerator, we need to calculate the number of errors that cause aliasing, which is equal to the number of non-zero m error of x that are divisible by f of x. We already know that there are 2 to the power of m non-zero m error polynomial, out of which every 2 to the power of n polynomial can be divisible by f of x. So we know that this number would be 2 to the power of m minus n divided by 1, which is all zero polynomial. So in the numerator, this number will be this. Now we can calculate the PAL, which is equal to 2 to the power of m minus n minus 1 over 2 to the power of m minus 1, which is approximately equal to 2 to the power of minus n if m is much larger than n. For example, for a 5 degree LFSR where n is equal to 5, the PAL is approximately 1 over 32. For a 6 degree LFSR, PAL is 1 over 64. This is a very good news because LFSR increase 1 bit, we can dramatically decrease PAL by 50%. So PAL decrease exponentially with the number of n. Now we already know that LFSR is a very good ORA. How can we design an LFSR to serve as an ORA? Here we show a simple design guideline. Given a target probability of aliasing, we need to design an LFSR as ORA. The first thing is that we will need to decide the number of flip-flops in the LFSR, that is the number n. According to this PAL equation, we can see that the target of PAL is equal to 2 to the power of minus n, so that the number of stage can be simply calculated by this equation. N is equal to minus log 2 PAL. The second question is that we need to decide the polynomial. The primitive polynomial is better than non-primitive polynomial. The reason will be given in the next slide. And the third step is that we need to make sure that the test length m must be much greater than number n. For example, suppose our target PAL is 1 out of a million, 10 to the minus 6. And the test length, that is the number of bitstream, is 1000 bits. We can calculate that if n is equal to 20, the PAL would be close to 1 out of a million. Then we can find a primitive polynomial of degree 20 in the primitive polynomial table. For example, x to the 20th plus x cubed plus 1 is a primitive polynomial. We can use this polynomial in our LFSR. Because the number m is equal to 1000, which is much greater than 20, so our assumption here is valid. In this way, we have designed a good ORA using a simple LFSR. In the previous slide, we mentioned that primitive polynomial is better than non-primitive polynomial. This has been a research topic published in 1988. In this research, they show that PAL of primitive polynomial converge to final steady state value faster than non-primitive polynomial. The following two figures shows the aliasing probability versus the test length. On our left hand side, we can see that for primitive polynomial, the PAL converge to steady state quickly. However, for non-primitive polynomial, the right figure shows that the aliasing probability is still quite high for the same test length. So this figure shows that using primitive polynomial is a better choice than non-primitive polynomial. In summary, in this video, we have analyzed LFSR base ORA. We show that type 2 or modular form LFSR is actually a Galois field 2 divider. Aliasing occurs when M arrow is divisible by the characteristic polynomial of LFSR. The aliasing probability of FR is equal to 2 to the power of minus n, where n is LFSR degree. So LFSR is a very good output response analyzer because the PAL is very, very low. And it is a good idea to use primitive polynomial instead of non-primitive polynomial. Thank you for watching.